Okay, my dear learners, no need to banging your head against the glass. Let's talk about assessing the fit of the mean, sum of squares, variance and standard deviation. In this video, we will discuss degrees of freedom as well. So stay with me for the whole video. Now let's talk about any statistical model. Our main purpose is to assess the fit of the proposed model to our observed data. So basically we're talking about how we can fit our model to the observed data. And you remember in my last video, I was talking about don't jump into our linear model first. Let's see your observed data first. Now, one of the simplest model used in statistics is the mean. You know, you might think about regression and all that model, but you know, my dear learners, it starts with mean. And let's talk about an example. If we took a 5 economics lecturer, let's say where I am working at the moment, and measured the number they had, number of friends they had, I might write the friends, measured the number of friends, okay? Number of friends they had, we might find the data is 1, 2, 3, 4, 3 and 4. I mean, these are the numbers, number of friends, these 5 economics lecturers had. Now, if we take the mean number of those friends, then we will have 1, 2, 3 plus 3 plus 4 divided by the 5 number of the lectures and we will get 2.6. Of course, in reality, you do not have 2.6 friends, right? Anyway, this is the hypothetical number for our demonstration purpose. Don't worry about these equations. Let me talk about something about what this equation actually means. The easiest way to do this is to look at the difference between the data we observe and the model fitted. Most of the cases, statistical models, we can determine whether the model is accurate by looking at how different our real data are from the model that we have created. In this case, our model is the mean, and we would like to see the difference between the observation that we have collected from the mean. The line representing the mean can be thought as our model. For instance, this is the line and this is the mean. This line represents the model 2.6, our model value. And the circle are the observed data. And these circles, for instance, this one, this one, this one and this one, these are all circles, which is the distance between the mean and the observed data. The diagram, this diagram also has a series of vertical lines. You see, this is the vertical line, this one is the vertical line, this is the vertical line. Okay, these are the series of vertical lines. Okay, this series of vertical lines that connect each observed value to the mean. You see, this is the connecting of the value. So every observations are connected from the mean or the distance from the mean and can be taught as the error in the model. So actually, if there is no error, then our actual observation and the mean will be the same line, right? But since the observations are deviate from the mean, and therefore you see there is one here, there is one here, there is one here, so the deviations from the mean is the error of our model. We can calculate the magnitude of these deviances by simply subtracting the mean value from each of the observed values, which means this is the what we are talking about. Xi is the observation value and x bar is the mean or 2.6 in our case. For example, lecturer 1 had only one friend. In this case, the lecturer 1, the x-axis shows the lecturer, the y-axis shows the number of friends the economics lecturer have. So lecturers 1 have only one friend. Okay, so what is happening here? Xi minus x bar, so 1 minus 2.6. So the lecturer 1 has minus 1.6 error value. You might notice that this deviance is a negative number. Here you can see it's a negative number, and this represents the fact that our model overestimates the lecturer 1. The lecturer 1's popularity. Why? You see here, we are talking about 2.6, each lecturer will have their friend. I mean, 2.6 is their average friend numbers. But in reality, the lecturer 1 has only one friend. So, 1.6 minus 1.6 is the overestimation of our observation lecturer 1. In other case, we can say we are making him over popular in the friend circle. It predicts that he will have 2.6 friends, yet in reality, he has only one friend. One possibility is to add up. Now, how can we use this deviance to estimate the accuracy of the model? So there are every possible deviances from the mean. How can we measure the accuracy of the model? And one possible way is to add up. Okay. One possible way is to add up the deviances. I mean the differences. Here, the differences. Okay. Differences. The one that I just showed the example. Okay. And if we are do so, this would find the observations in this way. Okay. The total error. And in other words, it called the sum of deviances. Total error, the sum of deviances. The interesting thing here is that the result tells us, you see the result is zero. The result tells us that there is no total error between our model and the observed data, which means it says that our model and the observed data has the same line. But in reality, it's not right. Now that it is of course clearly showing that it's not true. There were errors, but some of them were positive, like for example this one and this one, and some of them are negative, for instance this one and this one, minus 1.6, minus 6, right? Some were negative and they have simply cancelled each other out. It is clear that we need to avoid this problem to find out the accurate error in our model. And in order to do that, we introduce sum of squared errors. Now, here is our sum of squared error equation. So it's very easy. Actually, it is just the squaring of our observed error. So there are two times multiplication of the difference between the observed value from the mean. And therefore, you can say the square value of every possible deviance. From the mean, we squared it, we got 5.20. Now we can find out that our model is not accurate. Instead, we have 5.20 sum of squared error. Okay. Now, the sum of squared in a statistical term is a good measure of the accuracy of our model. However, it is fairly obvious that you can see here the sum of squared error is dependent upon the amount of data that has been collected. The more data points, the larger the number of sum of squared error, right? So in order to avoid this problem, if we are interested only in the average error of the sample, then we can divide the whole number by n. N means the number of observations. However, we are generally interested in using the error in the sample to estimate the error in the population. We are generally interested what? In using the error in the sample. We are interested in error in the sample to estimate the error in the population. Since we do not have the error in the population at the first place, so we need sample error to represent the population error or predict the population error. So we divide the SS, the sum of square, by number of observations minus 1. Okay, now the question is, why n minus 1? Why not only n, the number of observations? You see here the variance equation, sum of squares, n minus 1, the sample variance. This is the sample variance. Now, why n minus 1? And here comes the degrees of freedom concept. Now, degrees of freedom. Let's assume an interesting example. Let's assume that we have a cricket team and you have a team with 11 players or 11 empty places in the field for these 11 players to be positioned. There is a standard format in cricket, so each player has the 11 specific positions when they are fielding in the field, right? I mean, when they are bowling and fielding, not batting, right? So how can we do that? For the as more players arrive, you will each the point at which 11 positions have been filled. For instance, let's say one of the player came in the field, so you have left 10 positions, and this first one player, you can set him in square positions, or you can say put him in the point positions, you know, long on, long off, anywhere you can put him, because you have the independence or freedom to first player to set any positions out of the 11 positions, Likewise, the more number of players arrive, the number of options or the freedom will be reduced. Now let's talk about the final number player, let's say the 11th number. So, and you have only, after fulfilling 10 positions, you have only one position left, which means the 11th positions, right, in the field. So finding no other way, you have to put him into that particular positions. You do not have any choice, even if the fielder doesn't want to field there, but since all the other members of the team occupied the places, so you do not have the option to put him other places. Instead, you put him the only option that you have. You see, this is the something called the degrees of freedom concept in the statistics, where you can freely vary the number of observations. For example, if we take a sample of four observations, okay, and in these four observations, the four scores are free to vary in any way, let's assume. However, if we then use this sample of four observations to calculate the standard deviation of the population, we have to use the mean of the sample as an estimate of the population's mean. Thus, we hold one parameter constant. For example, in this case, the mean, let's say 10. So we assume the population mean is also 10. We want to keep this constant, I mean this value 10 constant. With this sample mean 10, the parameter is fixed because we would like to make it constant. Now all these four score from our sample, can it be vary at one time? The answer will be no, right? Because to keep the value constant, only three values from our four observations are free to vary. For example, if the values were in the sample 8, 9, 11 and 12, for instance, the mean will be 10. And if we change the values, these three values, let's say 7, 15 and 8, then the final value must be 10. Otherwise, you cannot make it 40, right? To keep the mean constant. And therefore, for the sample observations, when we divide the total observation numbers for finding out the standard deviation variance, we do n minus 1 instead of simply dividing it by n number of observations. And that is the why we hold one parameter constant, then degrees of freedom must be 1 less than the sample size. And if the sample size is n, then n minus 1 for the sample variance, a standard deviation calculation. For example, this is the example of a standard deviation of the sample. I hope you understand the assessing the mean, the importance of mean in the model building, the variance, the standard error, sum of squared error in this tutorial. So that the sum of squares, variance and standard deviation are all therefore measure of the fit. I mean, how well the mean represents the data. Mean, again I should say, the simplest model in statistics to start with observing or fitting your data into a model. In next tutorial, we'll talk about standard error. Till then, stay tuned and do subscribe of my channel. Bye bye.